Okay. So in democracy, you know, when we talk about democracy, I said to you that democracy is a form of government in which the people will elect the rulers. It doesn't mean that all the people will sit together and make the decision. It is not like that. So one of the person has to be elected as the democratic ruler. Okay, here are the two examples to understand how democracy can be implemented in a country. Like a democracy also can be implemented in, you know, in a class or in a family as well, where everyone is given equal importance. Like, you know, in a family, usually a son, a daughter, you know, they too are given equal importance. So then we can tell that there is a democracy existing. Even in a class, when questions are asked, when children participation is there, you know, democratic principles can be followed. So democracy can be existed by, you know, with proper consultation, with proper discussions, and with proper implementation, it can run smoothly. So such, we call it as a democracy. I think I have already talked about this Gram Sabha and how a Gram Panchayat will be taking up a decision. All these we have discussed. So democracy is such a thing that, you know, it involves everyone. Everyone should be there, discussed. Everyone should be consulted. All such kind of things should go on in democracy. Then only democracy is considered as democracy. Okay. So let us see what are the exact features of democracy. When we talk about democracy, you know, usually the question will come up that who are going to rule the democratic nation. Or what kind of elections are going to be constituted, and who are the people who will be electing their rulers, and what form of the government is going to be there. All these kind of aspects and questions will come up. So by and large, it depends that what kind of government is going to be there in democracy and how they are going to rule it. So even you can go by the definition of Abraham Lincoln. You know, Abraham Lincoln has already said a definition that democracy is a form of government. You know, it is of the government of the people, by the people, and for the people. We might have heard of this definition. Okay.
Yes.
Now here, these are the four features of democracy. These are the four features of democracy. Like what kind of a ruler is going to be coming up when we elect a ruler in democracy? What, how you are going to conduct the elections? What is the role of people in the government, in the democracy? And what is the role of government in the democracy? How do they function, and in what way they are important in democracy? with all examples we are going to see. The story of Pakistan I have already said about. Like in 1999 till October, it was Nawab Sharif who was the Prime Minister of Pakistan, a democratically elected person. But in October 99, it was General Pervez Musharraf, the head of the army, he took over the charge by a military coup.
October 1999.
So this man, by force, he has formed the government in 1999, and then after forming the government in 2002, he designated himself from CEO to the president by giving a referendum, a kind of a rule, a kind of a law that he has brought up. And this he has done with, by force, with all the legislatures, all the MLAs and MPs were by force made him to accept as a president. By bribing them, by offering them, by threatening them, by a lot of fraud and malpractice, he has done this. Okay, so thereby, this man, by some means, he tried to remain in the post for a longer period of time. Though the country was following a democratic system, this man has come out of democracy, has formed the government. So thereby, we cannot tell that particular country as a democratic country when you see such people of ruling the country. Okay. So referendum is nothing but a kind of a voting that he did. With they have a chance of they have a choice of either accepting him or rejecting him. Anyhow, as he is holding the power there right now under the gunpoint or under the military guidance, he made everyone to accept those. So by force, by bribing, and all the other means, he has brought that referendum in practice. So thereby, a lot of fraud has taken place, which later on, based on that fraud itself, this man has been put into the jail. Right now, he is also in the jail. So the legal frame order that was given by him in the month of August 2002 has extended his post for another 5 years, and moreover, this man could be becoming the president for a longer period of time without following the constitution of Pakistan. See what kind of a rule he brought. Though the elected representatives are there from the people, they are subservient to the military. The superior power will lies in the hands of the army itself. Such a law he brought in Pakistan. So he became supreme. And I told you the story behind how he became the ruler of Pakistan, how he had been continuing as the president of Pakistan, that I told you. And at the same time, when he tried, he was the one who did not like the kind of relationship that was growing between Atal Bihari Vajpayee here in India and as well as there with Nawaz Sharif. So here also in Iraq and Poland, actually those countries, you know, they were belonging to their own country, but America tried its best to bring the government of their choice in Iraq, and USSR tried to bring the government of their choice in Poland. So such kind of governments cannot be called as a complete democratic governments. So in democracy, the ruler who is elected directly by the people, he should have all the powers, not the other people who have come up in the middle, who come up by force, who come up with the domination of other countries. Such countries or such governments cannot be called as a democratic form of governments. Okay, so that is, you might have understood with the first feature of democracy, that how a ruler should be, that all the major decisions should be in the hands of an elected representative, not in the hands of others. Now the second feature is elections, and the elections that happen in a democracy, the rule, it says that the democratic method, it says that all the elections in a democratic country should be conducted freely and fairly. Freely in a sense without any money, without any influence. Fairly in a sense without any unfair practices, without any malpractices. So let us see with some examples that how in some countries no free democratic elections are held, no fair elections are held. Let us see in some examples. Okay, the hot topic, China is right now. So how elections happen there in China, we will see. And we'll compare the kind of elections happen in India. Here in India, you see elections are given to all according to the universal adult franchise. Every 18 years of person will get a chance to right to vote. Right. So every 18 years of age person will get a chance to vote. And every person has a chance to give a vote to the party that they like, to the politician that they like, to the person that they like. There are no restrictions. But whereas in China, it is slightly different. Ours is a multi-party democracy. China is a single-party democracy. I think I have already said this point also. There is only one single party functioning in the entire China, and that is the Chinese Communist Party. Let us see an example. How does it operates there in China? So like any other country, here also the elections are conducted for every 5 years. Here in India also, the elections are conducted for 5 years. So that's the name of the parliament in Chinese language. Anyhow, it is very difficult. You can remember that in National People's Congress. Okay. The parliament of the China, it is called as a National People's Congress. China is such a big country that it needs almost like 3,000 representatives from different parts of China. Like in India, you know, we have got 545 representatives representing different parts of the country. In the same manner, China has got 3,000 members, quite a big one because of the big country, maybe. And out of those 3,000 people, one will be elected as the president of the country. Okay. Whereas in India, you know, we elect our own prime minister. We have a choice of electing the prime minister of our own. Now, what person we like, which political party we like, we have a chance. Like out of 545 members, you know, all these 545 members, they'll be elected from, you know, different political parties. But whereas, in particularly in India or in India, we elect from different countries. Whereas in China, all the leaders are elected from only one political party, and that is the Chinese Communist Party itself. Somebody has unmuted. Please mute it back. See how difficult it is and how control it is on the elections, that it is not fair enough that the candidate who want to contest in election should get approval from the party which is ruling there in China. It is so undemocratic in nature. You cannot call it as a complete democracy. One cannot be, you know, a candidate cannot be rejected by a political party. A person should have, even in India, you see, even if a party rejects, one political party rejects a candidate, the candidate has a choice to stand in elections as an independent. But whereas here, the rejected candidates cannot contest in elections. Such a control is there in all these aspects. So anybody who is contesting an election should be a member of the Chinese Communist Party. Then only they'll be allowed to be a member in the elections and to contest in the elections. Otherwise, they are not allowed. And even if there are any other political party that is there, it should be allied with the CPI. The CPI should agree them that, okay, fine, you can be there and you can contest in the elections. Otherwise, if they are not tuning up with the CCP party, then they are not allowed to contest in elections. So there is only single party democracy in China. You can see the elections in democracy should be free and fair. But unfortunately, no fairness is there and no freeness is there in the conducting of elections here in China. So every elections after 5 years, only same political party will be there in the government. No other political party will get a chance to form the government. Whereas in India, you know, we give chance to every political party. If we don't like this party, we give a chance to the other. Like in Andhra, you might have seen. First, we gave a chance to TDP and now we are giving chance to YSRCP. If YSRCP is doing well and people all are satisfied, then we may continue to give the power to YSRCP once again. Otherwise, we may give chance to some other political party. Let us see another example that quite opposite conditions of a democratic elections actually. We will see another example where unfair means and malpractices are practiced in the conducting of elections. So you can also have an idea where exactly is Mexico. It is under the United Nations of America. Okay, so how Mexico is conducting the elections, you see, and make a note down of a political party that is existing here. It is called as PRI. Though I pronounce it, or though I write it as PRI, the expansion of PRI is Institutional Revolutionary Party. I'll write it in one way, but I'll give it expansion in the other way. Like you can see here how the PRI is written. Every elections that are conducted in Mexico, it seems, have been winning by a party called PRI. Every time. How is it possible that only single party is winning again and again, again and again? There is a reason. That means no free and fair elections are conducted. The democratic principle, the democratic feature that says about conducting the elections freely and fairly, it is not practiced in Mexico. Please note down the expansion of PRI, Institutional Revolutionary Party. I'm coming in reverse. Though it is written as PRI, the expansion is given in the opposite form. Institutional Revolutionary Party. Now you can imagine here, dirty tricks are always there in different parts. But here, the kind of a trick accepted by PRI is slightly different when compared to the other countries. It is not that PRI is very popular among the Mexicans. It is not that it is very famous in the country. But it is ruling in that particular country the way in which it has been conducting the elections. And it is not that the opposition is not available. Opposition is also there. Opposition also contests in the elections. But they never win. Why? What this party is doing, what PRI is doing, how they are winning, you see this.
For example,
Navya, please, you mute your cell phone, please. Navya. So here, what the PRI party is doing is that it is forcing the government employees, the government teachers, and even the parents who are sending their children to the government schools, they're forcing them to attend the PRI meetings. They convince them that they vote for them only, and if they don't vote, then the benefits of those things will not be coming up to them. Even the media is controlled by them. So thereby, all these aspects are helping them in winning the elections against the interest of people. So what is the interest of the people? They may not be ever coming to know, because here everything is maintained by and controlled by the PRI party. This money is also there here in India, but unfortunately this works and this doesn't work in some part of our country actually. Okay, so thereby a lot of illegal means and practices are followed by the PRI party here in Mexico to remain in power. So thereby, one of the democratic feature of conducting free and fair elections is not happening there in these two countries of China and Mexico that we have taken as an example. India is a perfect example where we can tell that free and fair are going on, but here and there few unfair activities that are happening, that are reported, and some are attended and some are not. It all happens in democracy. So obviously, when there is no chance of electing, or we are not having any alternatives, it's like the feature of democracy is not implemented here. Proper democracy is not existing here. Though they tell, so they conduct elections, they are conducting elections, but still we cannot tell that it is exactly the aspirations of the people are taken into consideration. Okay, let us see how another example of making you understanding, what is the role of people in democracy. See, there is a rule in democracy with regard to people. It says that one person will be given one vote of right, and one vote of right will have one value. It's like one person, one vote, and one vote, one value. So that is the principle of democracy, one of the features of democracy. Let us try to understand this even better. But unfortunately, this policy of one person, one vote, and one vote, one value is not followed in many countries, though they say that they are following and implementing democracy. Let us see some examples.
Even today, there are many.
Yeah, this was done till 2015. Till 2015, women were not having the right to vote. Women were not allowed to vote. Now they are given the right to vote, and now they are even allowed to run a taxi, you know, driving. They are not granted license in Saudi Arabia. They are not supposed to drive the vehicles. Now they are granted in Saudi Arabia the right to vote, and they have granted with the license. They can drive the vehicles. It is allowed now. But before 2015, the right to vote was not given to them. So what kind of a democracy is there? Of course, a complete democracy doesn't exist there. The kings are ruling out there. So here in Estonia, this country in Europe, you can see here exactly below Finland, the people here, especially belonging to the Russian minority, it finds it difficult to get the right to vote. They are not given the right to vote. Only the local Estonians have a chance to right to vote. Now, this doesn't mean, this is not a feature of a democracy. Democracy means every person, every citizen of their particular country should be granted the right to vote, and that should be considered with one value. That should be there. But unfortunately, all these countries, though they say that they have democracy, they don't follow the features of democracy. This is a controversial one. As much as, like, say, the value of the local Fijian, people who are born in Fiji, their value is more than those Fijians who have migrated from India. It happened once, you know, actually, say in the year 2007 or 8, that an Indian born has won the elections and had an every opportunity to become the prime minister of a Fiji. But unfortunately, though before he could take up the oath and all that, unfortunately, a civilian coup took place, just like how it happened in Pakistan. General Pervez Musharraf took up the charge. When Indian born has taken up control in Fiji, the Indian prime minister was taken away by a civilian, and he took over the control. So these are all undemocratic principles that are followed in few of the countries, and we cannot call them as a complete democracy. It cannot happen like this. A democracy should give every person one vote, and one vote should be granted as one value. It's not like here in Fiji, like, you know, a person who is born in Fiji will be given more value, and then the person who has migrated from Indian region, they'll be given the less value. This shouldn't be the principle of democracy. So thus we can say that every person should have one vote, and every vote will be valued as one value, not 10 or 12, not 10 or 15 or something like that. Now let us see the fourth feature of democracy. So let us see, once they have got elected as the, you know, the prime minister or a president of their particular countries in the beginning, you know, as democratically, after that, you know, they turn a little bit of undemocratic in nature, and they continue to rule. having seen and having been for 5 years as a ruler, they continue to take the opportunity to become and to continue as their rulers by undemocratic means. Let us see some examples. We'll see an example of Robert Mugabe, how he did there in Zimbabwe. Please make a note, where is exactly Zimbabwe in Africa? Zimbabwe is a country of blacks, okay? And from the beginning here, there has been a control of, after their independence from the Britishers, after their independence that they got from the white minority rule in 1980 that they got. And since then, one political party has been ruling there, and it was Robert Mugabe who had been ruling there in that particular country. Please note down, the popular party there from Zimbabwe is ZANU-PF party. ZANU, Z-A-N-U, ZANU-PF. I don't think so there is an expansion of ZANU, so you don't have to worry about it. You just need to remember the party name as ZANU, ZANU-PF. Please make a note of this person's name also. He died recently, I think somewhere around in 2019 he died at the age of almost like 95 and 96 years. And he ruled Zimbabwe for more than 37 years. Right from the time of independence, this man has been ruling in Zimbabwe. And it doesn't mean that this man was very favorite of all the people. It does not mean that he can continue, or he was there in power because people voted him continuously. They liked him. It's not like that. It's not like that. Once he got elected in the beginning, he continued to be there in the government by different means. How and all that, let us see. Yeah, PF is like Patriotic Front, ZANU Patriotic Front. So though elections were conducted, always in the elections, Robert Mugabe was winning because everything is under his control. The media is under his control, opposition is under his control, everything is under his control. So thereby he has been winning the elections since then, they have got the elections. Sharanya, what do you want me to repeat? What do you want me to repeat, Sharanya? Okay, so a democratic country or a democracy cannot be like how it was implemented in Zimbabwe, how it is implemented in Fiji, how it is implemented in Pakistan. Those are the few examples to make you understand that how important are the rulers, the people, the government, elections. All these four democratic features are very vital and very important. Everyone should have equal rights. Everyone should be given an equal opportunity. Everyone, every individual is important in the country. So such countries can be democratically correct countries. And thus the flourishing or the growth of a particular country depends upon how the governments are behaving actually. Yeah. Okay, once after winning the elections doesn't mean that all the governments or all the political parties can do whatever they like. Like you can take an example of Andhra's CM, YSR, you know, after winning the elections with 151 MLAs, doesn't mean that he can do whatever he like. He can do only those which are democratic in nature, which represents the ideology of the people. Then only it is possible. Okay. Who are the minorities? The minorities are the people who are less in number. Like in India, the minorities are Muslims, Buddhists, Jains, Sikhs. These are the minorities in the country. Even they should be respected, and honor guarantee should be there to those the minorities. If the minorities are not respected, if the minorities are not granted a proper dignity and all that, it may bring a blame and a spot on those democratic governments. Like it happened in Burma, like it happened in Myanmar, it is going on in China as well. The Muslims in Uyghur, I think the Muslims are being targeted and they are killed. Okay, in the same way how it is going on in Myanmar, all the Muslims particularly are targeted in those areas. So such kind of thing should not happen in a democratic country. I see many of them are talking about their problems. Like in the beginning, I saw some of them are unable to log in with their Cisco WebEx things, and some are living with the battery low. Anyhow, I'm close to the time. I'll stop it for a while now here at 17 minutes and 45 seconds. If you have got doubts till now, you can ask me, or else you can just log out, because I think even there is a power cut. Even our meeting is going to end in next 5 minutes. So before it end up automatically, I would like to stop it here itself. And if you have got any doubts, you can ask me. Or else you can log out from my class. Okay.